So, back by popular demand, Telly Talk with Millie Payne. Welcome back.
Thanks, Mark.
Exams are over, right?
Yeah, they are. Thank God.
Yeah, it feels so. So back to Maiden Chelsea, which is more important, of course.
Exactly. So
it's getting really weird, Maiden Chelsea. So for those that aren't watching it, it's on Channel 4, isn't it? It's at 9 o'clock and then repeated as well. I mean, just tell us where we are with the storylines, because it's getting complicated.
Yeah, very, very complicated. So they're still in the houses. I think it's...
Suffolk.
Yeah, Suffolk. I was about to say Sussex, and I thought, no, it's definitely Suffolk.
Yeah.
And the drama is just getting... I mean, it was here a few weeks ago, and now it's here. It's just nuts. But I think, I don't know whether you agree. I mean, I'm assuming, because it's on weekly, we can give away spoilers. I don't know about you and how you feel based on the previews for next week. I do feel like this whole series has been building up to Reza and Ruby breaking up, Ruby and Miles, the flirtatious energy between them, and then you've got sort of Inga in the middle, who's a bit jealous.
Yeah.
Maeva, who's consistently stirring the pot.
Everywhere she goes. She's stirring the pot. It's like incredible.
I loved it the other week when she was sat there with Tristan and Liv, and she went to storm off, but she couldn't open the door, so she had to knock. Someone had to let her in. Yeah. And I found it hilarious. I thought she's obviously wanted to have that big dramatic storm off, and all she's had to knock. But what's happening now is, so Inga used to be with Miles, and not really with. It was a fling. They've known each other for years, and then this new girl, Eloise, has come in again.
He's treating his ex. Well, it's not really his ex, but with contempt.
He's literally said, "I'd prefer it if you left." I know you can't, but I'd prefer it if you... I'm thinking she's got just as much right to be here as you have.
Yeah.
But I actually did feel weirdly sorry for him, because he actually didn't really do anything with Eloise. They were just talking. And it seems like Julius is more looking to go with Eloise. But Eloise is a very, very confident young lady. She's obviously ruffled a few feathers, I think. So it'll be very interesting to see... She doesn't really care what she says. So it'll be interesting to see how many people she annoys and how many people and what boy she ends up choosing.
Yeah. What about the fact that we had the three hunks, the trio.
What's
that about? So we're going to find out next week because we should say it's an Alzheimer's disease. It's Alzheimer's Society dinner that they held. Very swanky. I've never been to a charity dinner like that before.
I know. I mean, I thought it was going to be... because I know that Gareth and Liv had that really emotional moment where Gareth was talking about it. And I think it got to the break and I thought, I'm not going to be able to handle this because it's going to be so emotional. But I think it was lovely because it was very, like, Gareth's speech was very minimal, but it made its point. And then obviously Liv gave Gareth the photo, which I thought was very, very heartfelt. But I've never seen, a charity do quite so upmarket.
Yeah.
But I thought it was a lovely, lovely sentiment. And I thought it's nice that they're also using the show to raise awareness for such a sad cause as well. It'll be interesting to see what the tricep trio end up having to do for James, because that's who's now got them waiting on them hand and foot. So
So what do you think? It's going to all focus on Miles, isn't it? What is he going to have to clear up the dog's poop, like Maeva was saying?
I think even though James has won, Maeva will be overseeing that no matter what. I think she'll have Miles doing all the worst jobs. She'll probably have the other two, I don't know, maybe they'll be his assistants, but I think Miles will be that poor guy who's having to do everything.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. So what do we think of Miles' conduct then? Because, it's not looking great, is it, for him, really, the way he's treating women? What would you say? And, you know, we won't say it's a swear word, but he's got a reputation about...
Yeah, something messing around, yeah.
Messing around with women. I mean, do you think there's a message there about how men treat women?
Do you know what? I think, without a doubt, I think I will never forget in the first episode, I think he was coming on to Ruby quite strongly, knowing that she was with someone. I don't know if that, at the beginning, I think that's just his personality, maybe quite naturally flirtatious. Then obviously for next week's preview, we see that he says to Ruby, hurry up and break up with your boyfriend.
Yeah.
And I don't know, I was watching that and I was like, oh, you cringe because you think, oh, no, no. But then obviously Reza and Ruby are very much, we don't know, because that was the whole other thing, wasn't it, with Reza and Verity. We don't know the extent to how much they've been messaging, so you don't know who is really the guilty party here. I think Miles, the problem with Miles is he does come across really likeable.
Yep.
So everyone, he's sort of got this beaming smile, but I think he gets himself into trouble. And does he mean to be... that word that we're referring to, I don't know. Is he just waiting for the right person? Maybe. I think how he dismisses Inga, whether they were serious or not, and just doesn't acknowledge her, maybe that's his way of dealing with it, but it doesn't come across very well.
Because Inga says that she's slept with a lot of guys, and she can't. This is a thing in society, and she gets stick for that. But then the guys are doing it.
It's my pet hate.
And this is like, and there's nothing wrong with what they're doing. It's not illegal. It's best they want to live their life. They can do what they want. But it's the fact that she's getting stick for it. She's getting abused for it. Whereas Miles is doing it, and he doesn't. He seems
The girls are almost downgraded for it, whereas the boys are held in really high regard, or they're amazing for doing what they're doing. But it's weird though, because I think there was conversations in last night's or the week before, is about how the single people were actually quite glad for other single people to come in, because they're sort of consumed by being around couples. And you look at the couples, and the clip for next week shows that Liv and Tristan perhaps aren't as happy, and they're breaking up. And because he's been a bit moody this series.
Yeah, it does look like Liv and they're going to break up.
Yeah.
Because we saw that little snippet right at the end, didn't we, of that episode? And it looks like they've broken up.
Yeah, and I don't know.
Which
I found
quite shocking, really, because they were getting.
Yeah, but then you think there's obviously been quite people. I think the common denominator in all of these relationships is people are always involved. Yeah. People are always involved in them. So there's no real, escape, and they can't deal with their problems just them two, because you've got someone's friends with someone in their ear, and then but that person's also friends with them who's telling, and you think it must be impossible to feel like your problems are just your problems, and no one else knows what's going on.
So that's made in Chelsea then, and that's and people can just go on catch up, can't they, with that, and get made in Chelsea. Bridgerton, I've not seen Bridgerton. I've looked at it because it's on Netflix, isn't
it? Yes.
But I've not actually watched an episode.
Do you know what? I'm quite actually late to the party, I think, because it was, I'm trying to think when it would have been, maybe after Christmas, that first national lockdown again, and it was everywhere. I looked at sort of the preview, and I thought it's quite, obviously it's a period drama. So I thought, I was never massively into something like Downton Abbey with the big ball gowns. And I thought, I don't know if I'm going to like it. And me and my housemate, we were like, right, let's have a go. And we got hooked from the hour episodes, but you never feel like they're an hour. You feel it is pure escapism. And I think for the ladies, especially, the Duke is definitely some eye candy, but he's not in the next series, which I think people are absolutely gutted about. But they're based on books, so
we're talking 18th century here.
Yeah, right. So they're all based on books, but it's really cool actually, because when they go to these big events, they have like background music, and the background music is like people playing violins of 21st century music, and I just found it hilarious. I thought it's obviously bringing together the two time periods, but it's if you're having a bit of a really rubbish day, don't know what to stick on, it's pure escapism, because it's beautiful. It's a love story. You've also got like family riffs and all things like it's a beautiful, beautiful story.
And it's done well in America, Bridgerton, hasn't it? Because that's what the Americans think, that we still kind of live like that. I'm sure they do, some Americans.
Well, it's the big carriages, it's the big ball gowns, it's the getting ready for events and doing your hair really lovely. But that's what I said. I said, I'm jealous. I said, they had a ball every night to go to. But they'd be pre-planning who was going to be dancing with who and who's going to sweep who off their feet. And then there's also, because people have said it ties in with sort of the modern day Gossip Girl, because there's someone who writes about all the goings on in the town, and not until the final episode do you find out who's been writing these letters. And obviously it's like you know, they get the, it's not a newspaper, but like a pamphlet delivered every morning. And it's weird, both my housemate and I guessed quite early on. But I spoke to my mum and sister who'd watched it months ago, and they said, oh, we never guessed it was her. So it's different hat, it's
journalistic
weird.
Journalistic mind, see?
The invest. I was like, oh, that makes sense, it's her because of this.
She's asking all the right questions.
So I would definitely recommend, for someone as me, I'm not really into the period dramas at all. But it definitely, if you like Gossip Girl, like Pretty Little Liars, that kind of American teen dramas, then I would definitely say give it a go.
And was this ever on ITV, or was it just a budget? Was it a Netflix budget?
Just Netflix.
Right.
So I think again they're based on a series of books, so they they will obviously be coming out in succession. I think series 2 and 3 have been confirmed.
Yeah.
And I think that they're starting to film the second one. Obviously, right. Again, with COVID restrictions, we'll see how that goes.
Just before we break up, any for the first half, that is, that's any news on The Crown? When are we going to see more Crowns?
Oh, do you know what? I'm really not sure. I've actually started to get back into that again because I think I've been watching so many other things in between. But do you know what? I'm really not sure. And I guess for that as well, it's...
They've got
to film it all. It's the budget. It's obviously COVID in amongst that. Obviously, season 4 received quite a lot of backlash. The producer's going to have to be more careful with season 5. But I haven't read anything as such when it's coming out. But that's definitely something to look out for.
Yeah, brilliant. All right, that's the first half. Join us for the second half. I'll be catching up a lot more with Teddy on Teddy Talk with Millie. So join us then. So back here for Teddy Talk with Millie Payne, and so talking a bit about viewpoint now, and a bit about the kind of the Me Too movement, really. Just tell us a bit about what's been going on. Obviously, there's not been no court cases or anything like that.
No.
But we can talk generally about what's been going on. Some shows that have been taken off air because of kind of sexual misconduct allegations.
So I think Viewpoint was on maybe 3 or 4 weeks ago, and I'd heard a lot about it. I actually binge watched it all in one day because I really, really loved it. But before I actually watched it, I know they'd been showing, I think, on consecutive evenings. And then I'd read these allegations had come out about Noel Clark, who played the DC in Viewpoint. And they'd taken off the last, or I think, I don't know whether it was on ITV Hub at this point, but they said they were not showing the final episode because of these allegations that had come forward. And then again, mad how social media gives different narratives. There are people obviously, well, I've watched 4 episodes, I need to know how it ends. And then obviously, like you said, with the Me Too movement, and because it involves such serious matters, people were like, well, no, it shouldn't be shown. But I think this Noel Clark had just won an Oscar. I think he'd obviously delivered a speech. And now there was that whole question around, well, how many people knew that was going on? Because I think it was a fair few allegations that were made. And then the more people I spoke to about it, they said, well, should it have been taken off? Because nothing's been proved innocent until proven guilty. So there are all these different arguments, I think, that come through with it. But the show as a whole, I really enjoyed. And obviously the final episode, as it normally does, tied everything together. But I don't think anything, I don't know how the story's progressing now. I don't know if he's going to court. I don't really know.
We don't know, but I think the main story here is that, you know, there's these allegations by a number of various women. So shows have been taken off, haven't they? And so that's, in a way, that's no one's been proven guilty or not guilty.
No.
But it shows you the change in attitude. That's what we're saying, isn't it? Really?
Yeah, it definitely. I mean, it's a strange one because I know, I don't know if I think my grandparents have watched and said, we just can't get the last one anywhere. But yet, as soon as I went on to ITV Hub, they were all readily available. So I still am unsure whether ITV broadcast it in live time or whether they just put it on the hub for people to go and watch. But I do think it's quite... As producers, as directors, or who makes the airing decisions, that must be such a hard... It must be such a hard decision to think he'd only shown... I think by the time Viewpoint was out, I think he'd only won an Oscar a few days ago. So there's all these things. Did people at the Oscars know it was going on? Should he have been allowed to have won his Oscar knowing that these things were going on behind... allegedly happening behind the scenes. But I don't really know how that's going to progress. But the show, I thought, was fantastic. I did hear mixed reviews about the ending. Obviously, I won't give anything away, but that's, as I'm aware, that's all on the ITV Hub to go and watch.
Yeah. Martin Bashir then, that Diana interview, I remember that back in the day. Have you ever seen it? Because you probably can't get it now, but you could have.
I've seen snippets from it.
So what do you think about that? I know you're studying journalism. I mean, obviously it was an interview of the decade that Martin Bashir secured there, but obviously not through the proper means.
No. Yeah. So, because I think there was a lot's been in the news about this recently, as in not just over the last few days, but as in, I think, earlier on this year as well, about a full investigation was going to go ahead into how he conducted himself ethically. So, and obviously as a wannabe journalist, we look at all the ethics involved in, right, okay, what should you do in hypothetical situation A, B, C? And obviously he did, I think he deceived her with banknotes and letters and statements and what else. And then obviously now, after the full review, he's obviously come out and it has been confirmed that how he went about that was ethically wrong. And I know that Prince William has spoken out and things like that. But then I've also seen articles that show Martin Bashir's family were very close with Diana. And Diana went, I'm pretty sure she was photographed at the birth of Martin and his wife's third child at the birth. So I haven't worded that very well, but yeah. You think, and his defence is, well, she was happy with the interview, but then she might have been happy with it, but then you've deceived her into having that interview. But then it gave her voice to get out what had happened. But then I think from William's side, he then said, well, that triggered everything else, because then the press were just obsessed with Diana. And then obviously it was a car crash that killed her after the paparazzi were trying to get to her. So I don't know. It's a tough one.
It's difficult. I mean, Martin Bashir just seems to get most of the blame when you've got, like, Tony Hall, the Lord Hall, former Director General of the BBC. Yeah. He was the head of news back then as well. So there's other people involved there. A lot of people knew about it and just tried to cover it up, pretty much. I mean, that's what the report pretty much concluded, right?
Yeah, and I think for those people that have kept that, that's... Okay, Martin Bashir was the head of the unethical conduct, but then you've got all these people behind the scenes. Yeah. In the same way with Noel Clarke, you've got probably people behind the scenes that are aware of allegations, are aware of misconduct. And then if you sit on that, are you just as bad as the person who's... Because you've got to think, there would have been a lot of people that would have known that interview was done under very poor circumstances. So I think, I don't know how you would, not live with that, but how you would carry on your day-to-day workings, knowing that, oh my goodness, like we have allowed that to happen.
Yeah.
But I think I've seen quite a few BBC resignations. I think someone who was quite high up in the BBC, he's resigned.
Yeah. That's Lord Hall from that portrait.
Yeah.
National Gallery, I should say.
So you think it makes you wonder how many other people are perhaps going to come forward and stand down in recognition of, well, this is wrong. Yeah. So it's quite an interesting time for journalism as well, because you think a lot more research probably going to be done over the next coming weeks of actually, like, how many other times has this happened? So I think he moved from BBC to ITV. Yeah. Was there other work he did there that was perhaps unethical? So I think there's going to be a lot of tracing back.
He interviewed Michael Jackson, didn't he, as
yes,
well?
Yes, I think there's been some complaints about that since.
Yeah, there has, yeah. So does that change the way you think about the BBC? Because I think one of the issues that some people have the BBC is that they pretend they're hardier than now, but then, you know, they're making mistakes. And obviously the tabloid press we had the hacking, journalists went to prison, didn't they?
Yeah.
Out of the phone hacking scandal. Four or five News of the World journalists there went to prison. Andy Coulson, the former editor. So
yeah,
it went up to the top there and people paid a heavy price for that. What about the BBC? I mean, is it the fact that they place themselves on the pedestal above everyone else? Is that what they come under fire?
Yes, I definitely think so. Like you said, they perceive themselves as being here, very perhaps, like you said, on a pedestal. However, do I think that all news organisations are perhaps innocent in their journalistic conduct, no matter whether it's a small story, a big story? I don't know, because, I mean, who was it? Was it Channel 4, I think, that broadcast a massive Michael Jackson documentary? Insinuating that he'd obviously been like X, Y, and Z with children and all things like that. And I think there was a lot of complaints that shouldn't have been aired. So I think if you look at all news organisations, whether it's a paper, whether it's a online organisation, there's probably, you can always trace back unethical conduct. And is it right? No. Should BBC come under fire? Yes, because they obviously allowed that interview to happen and there would have been people behind the scenes aware of it. But I think you're right, it's because they view themselves as being here, they always have been perceived as being here and maybe the others here, that's why they come under so much fire.
Yeah, exactly. So is there circumstances when you could use those tactics, false bank statements? I mean, if you're after a murderer or something, is this something that comes up in your course? I mean,
yeah,
there are circumstances when you can break the law, but this
definitely
obviously wasn't one. This, and he probably didn't need to do it. I get the sense that Diana wanted to have an interview and she was going to give it to someone because Charles had gone before and come out, hadn't he, and said things. So she wanted to put the record straight.
Is in a similar way. I know social media wasn't a thing when that interview was taken, but in the same way, that was the whole debate with Meghan. She needed to get her story out there. Did Diana want to do the same? Would she have done the same without being deceived? This is, I think, probably something we'll never know. I mean, I've read that, I think Martin Bashir has claimed that she was very much, like, she was content to have the interview, but it's obviously, it's everything else that comes with it. But we, on our course, we learn that if you use anything like hidden cameras, like listening devices, or just basically obtaining information by unethical means, it should really only be justified if you're doing it in the public interest. So, like you said, with a murderer. But then you could have some people arguing, well, the royal family, that is public interest, so we should know. But I don't think that would have quite cut it, because obviously it's really, it was quite an involved interview, wasn't it?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So just before we finish up on that, I mean, where do you think it's all going to end then? BBC have been tarnished, probably going to have different regulatory regime that they're going to fall under. Looks like the government are going to get involved and shake things up a bit at the BBC.
I think we'll probably see a lot. I don't know how many resignations we'll see from different areas. I do think that will happen. I know that obviously the government will definitely be heavily involved. I think, will it change the way the interviews are? I know interviewing at the moment is quite difficult. I know a lot of them still have been going on through Zoom and whatnot. Will the process of interviewing change? Yeah. So will they have to prove X, Y and Z that I got this interview by this? And I think there will be stricter regulation on how people get their interviews. And they'll be having people having to probably, I don't know, prove themselves a lot more instead of it just, I got this interview by this. Yeah. Okay, that's fine. You can do it.
Accountability.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
All right, Millie, we'll leave it there. We're going to catch up again soon. Take care.
Thanks. You.